morning, Central Family. How's everybody this morning? Good to see all of the familiar and faces that we haven't seen in a little while. Good to see you all here. Glad you made it here safely. And we pray that your time together with family and friends is a blessing. And let's stand together this morning. We'll have a word of prayer and we'll begin our time of praise together this morning. Great and gracious Heavenly Father, we just are truly grateful for just this time that we can come together as your family, Father. We just thank you for each one here. We just thank you so much, especially for this time of year when we do celebrate the birth of your Son. We just thank you so much, Father, that you sent him on our behalf and made our lives something that we can look forward to. And we just pray for each one here this morning, Father, that you would just open our hearts and our minds to you, Father, knowing that you are the reason that we're here, knowing that you are with us this morning. Just bless our time of praise, and may it all be for you. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. To those around you that you haven't seen for a while this morning. Hate to end this time, but as you make your way back to your seats, we're going to continue singing some Christmas carols this morning about our Lord and Jesus. Thank you. this time, just we worship can be released to go back for we worship. No junior worship this morning, just we worship. So if those kids want to take off, they can. As we turn our thoughts to a time of prayer this morning, just keep all of those in mind that have been on our prayer list in the past. Sounds like Rhoda is getting along pretty good with her surgery. Bob is here this morning, and things went well with his, and he's doing good. Keep Judy in your prayers as she undergoes some more treatments. Any others this morning that need to be brought forth that we aren't aware of? All right. Keep those that are traveling. Of course, we had to have a little bit of slippery slidey to make the holidays fun. So keep those in your prayers that are traveling with us, and we'll be traveling back. So, all right, let's go to the Lord in prayer for a silent time of prayer this morning, and then I'll close. Precious Heavenly Father, we're so thankful this morning, Father, that you are the God that you are. We're so thankful that you are all-powerful, all-knowing, all-seeing, that you see our hurts even when we don't bring them forth, Father, that you see our joys and you hear us exclaim them to you. We just thank you for our answered prayers, Father, for each of those that have had successful surgeries, for healing that has been taking place, Father, and we know that all of that comes from your hand. We're just so grateful, Father, that we can have this time to celebrate your son. And we just thank you so much for him, Father, and for the gift that he is to our lives. We just pray for each one here, for unspoken prayers, Father, that you'll just be with each person in the way that only you know that they need you to be with them. Just thank you for this time and bless us as we continue. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Silent night.
couple light housekeeping tasks here. We want to invite you all to fill out a Connect card in the pew in front of you. Fill those out so that someone from the office can connect with you, especially if you're a visiting, your first time visitor, or haven't been here in a while. And you can replace those in the offering plate at that time of our service. Speaking of offering, there's more than one way to give. The offering plate isn't the only one. We do have an offering box in the back. If you prefer to do that way or don't get it done in time or any time, you can drop offering in there. Or if you're one of these technically savvy people, you can do it. Our website is GearingCentralChurch.org, and there is a give button in there, and you can give online if you so desire. And finally, our communion time, we do that just slightly differently these days. So if you haven't partaken with communion with us before, as the the plates are passed, they're double cupped. So just take both cups. There's a piece of bread in the bottom cup, juice on the top cup. You can take those, pass the tray along, and then when you can take your time, meditate on these thoughts of communion and partake when you want, and then those leftover the trash can be put in the receptacles that should be at the end of each pew on each side. So with that said, these thoughts on communion are brought to you by Jim Dietz. Andy, we should have had you do it this morning. You're here. But Jim is unable to get to worship with us, but he is online. So hi, Jim and Linda. Remember, you're being watched, folks, here. We welcome those that are online with us. And so thanks, Jim, for sharing with us this morning this way. So here we go. It's time of year where we celebrate Christ's birth. We see the words love and joy to the world and peace on earth on cards and on banners and on wall hangings. And names like Prince of Peace, Wonderful Counselor, King of Kings are used to describe a baby born under humble conditions, even laid in straw of a borrowed manger bed. The celebration at this time of his birth was really quite minimal. And of course, the day of his birth would not be remembered today if it were not for the events that surrounded his life. Events like healing the sick, raising the dead, and teaching a style of worship that was unsettling to the religious leaders of the time. And one of the more difficult teachings for his followers to grasp was his proclaiming his flesh to be the bread of life, and that those who would eat of his flesh and drink of his blood would live forever. While he made it clear that this was in the spiritual sense, even his closest followers would not understand this teaching until after he had been crucified and then conquered death by raising from the grave. As we partake of these emblems as a simple celebration of his death, burial, and resurrection, let us remember the words of Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 11, verses 23 through 26. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Father God, you are so good, and you are so mighty, and you are the King of Kings. So, Father, we are grateful, thankful this morning for the opportunity to assemble here in this place and to bring you worship and to bring you praise, to sing of your wondrous name. Father, we're grateful for the opportunity that we have to come around this table this morning to partake of this simple dinner, the juice and the bread, representing the blood and the body of Christ. Father, we're grateful for that sacrifice that we really celebrate this time of year. It's not just about the birth, but it's the life, it's the death, and it's the burial and resurrection that we can celebrate, and we do celebrate. So, Father, as we partake today, may we do it remembering you, remembering Jesus, and may we continue to proclaim him until he comes again. Pray this in Jesus' name, and because he still lives, amen.
Once again, we come around to the part of the service where we pass the offering plates and we give back to God what he asks for and what belongs to him. And I've said this on occasion. I've had the opportunity to be one of these men who pass the plates to each of you. And I want you to know that it's a privilege and an honor to see what happens in those plates. At the front, here they start out empty, but by the time that they reach the back, they contain the treasures that propel the work of God in this church. God takes our loaves and our fishes and makes it go to areas that we may not have even dreamed of, ministering to those where there is need. My wife and I have a saying, ministry costs money. As long as we bring our tithes and offerings, ministry will go on. So I encourage each of you today, give and see what the Lord will do with it. Matthew 10:8 says, freely received, freely give. Let's pray. God, we thank you for what we take so for granted, the things that you give us. You provide for our every need, and you give many of the things that we want, and we thank you for that. And today we just pray that what we bring is God-honoring to you, and that it will bless many and many in this season especially. And thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Probably going to be better than the sermon, so maybe we should just say in Jesus' name, amen, and go home, huh? Nah. Maybe you heard about the wise men who walked into Joseph and Mary's house sometime after the birth of Jesus. Joseph asked, "What are you doing here unannounced?" The first wise man said, I have brought gold for the child. Joseph thanked him but said it was a busy day and, you know, politely asked him to leave. And then the second wise man said, "I've also brought a gift of frankincense for the child." Again, Joseph thanked him, but starting to get annoyed as they had come in uninvited. Joseph then forcefully asked them to leave when the third man said, "But wait, there's myrrh." That one didn't work last year either. I thought I'd give you another try. I thought I'd give you another chance to totally redeem yourself, but nope. I once read the story of a little girl named Jana who was in a Christmas pageant. And this is the story as told by her mother. The day of the Christmas presentation finally arrived. My young daughter Jana was so excited about her part that I thought she was to be one of the main characters, though she had not told me what she was to do. The parents were all there, and one by one the children took their places, and I saw the shepherds fidgeting in the corner of the stage, meant to represent the fields for their sheep. And Mary and Joseph stood solemnly behind the manger. And in the back, three young wise men waited impatiently. But still, Jana just sat quietly and confidently. And then the teacher began. A long time ago, Mary and Joseph had a baby, and they named him Jesus, she said. And when Jesus was born, a bright star appeared over the stable. And at that cue, Jana got up from her chair and picked up a large tin foil star and walked behind Mary and Joseph and held the star up high for everyone to see. And when the teacher told about the shepherds coming to see the baby, the three young shepherds came forward, and Jana jiggled the star up and down excitedly to show them where to come. And when the wise men responded to their cue, she went forward a little to meet them and to lead the way, her face as alight as the real star might have been. And the play ended, and we had refreshments. And on the way home, Jana said with great satisfaction, "I had the main part." "You did?" her mother asked in surprise. "Yes," she said, "because I showed everybody how to find Jesus." We serve a mighty God and an everlasting Father when we serve Jesus. And the most important thing we can do on His behalf is to show others how to find Him. He's the mighty God, and He's the everlasting Father, and He does want to introduce Him to everybody we meet. Matthew 5:16 says, "Let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven." You know, there's a repeated message throughout Scripture, and it goes something like this. No one is going to get into heaven because they're nice people. You can give time and money and housing and clothing, and you can even give blood to help people. You can be as nice as you can possibly be, but you'll still not make it into heaven just because you're a nice person. Romans 3:23 says, "All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." Nobody is good enough to be good enough to get into heaven. Your sins have created a debt that must be paid. Romans 6:23 tells us the wages of sin is death. In other words, the price of your sin is somebody's death, either yours or somebody else's. Now here's the thing, I can't die for you. Even if I wanted to, I couldn't do it because I can't even pay for my own sins, let alone yours. But God can. When God stepped down from heaven and became a man and eventually died on a cross, He did that to exchange His life for your life and my life. And I love how the poet put it. He paid a debt He did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. I needed someone to wash my sins away. And now I sing a brand new song, "Amazing Grace. Christ Jesus paid a debt that I could never pay." That's the most important reason why Jesus being divine is so critical for you and me. But it means even more than this. He is the mighty God. We talked about that last week. He's the mighty God. Colossians says he's the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rules or authorities. All things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He's the mighty God. He's created everything, and he holds all things together by the power of his word. And what that means is, Jesus is big enough and powerful enough to supply us with whatever we need. I read the story of the wife of a preacher who decided to feed leftovers to her two boys. She gave the 60-year-old the remaining portion of an Italian dish called tortellini. Apparently, it was so good the first time around that the 8-year-old son wanted it too. And that's how the argument started. Well, the dad thought he'd try reasoning with the younger son. Jeremy, what would Jesus do in this situation? Thinking Jeremy would say he'd share. Instead, Jeremy looked up and said, "Oh, Dad, he'd just make more." That boy understood what it meant to have a Jesus who is the mighty God. He believed Jesus was able and willing to supply him with the things that he needed. And so you might be here this morning, and I don't know what's going on in your life, but you might have a big thing that's in your way. And you might say, "It's impossible." And Jesus would say, "All things are possible." Or you might be here this morning and you are just wasted. You're just tired. You just overwhelmed. You just need to rest. And Jesus says, "Come on to me and I will give you rest." You might say, "I can't go on another day." But Jesus says, "My grace will be sufficient for you." You might say, "I can't do it," whatever that thing is. "I can't do it." But Jesus will reply, "You can." And Paul says, written in the context of contentment, "You can do all things through me because I will give you strength." Jesus is the mighty God. And in addition, Isaiah 9 tells us that Jesus is the everlasting Father. He's everlasting to us. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Jesus has always been, and Jesus will always be. He is eternal. And he offers to share with us of that eternity. Jesus said, "I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life." And so once you've given yourself to Jesus and you've believed in his name and you've repented of your sins and you've been baptized in the waters and risen up to a new life, once you've done that, you've laid hold of eternity. And from that day on, you have the promise from the everlasting Jesus, "I will never leave you or forsake you." People we trust can fail and disappoint us. The company that we work for may fire us or go out of business. Governments and kingdoms will ultimately crumble and fall because that's the kind of world we live in. Nothing is permanent, except Jesus' commitment to us. Jesus will never leave us or forsake us. He is the presence of the everlasting Father, and He will not walk away from us. The last couple of weeks, we've been in Isaiah 9:6, looking at, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on His shoulders, and He will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Again, the prophet Isaiah wrote those words some 700 years before the shepherds found the baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. We've looked at Jesus as the Wonderful Counselor, that is, someone to give me good counsel, someone who I can rely on to listen to. Last week we saw Him as the Mighty God, that is, someone to save me. Today we want to look a closer look at Jesus as the Everlasting Father. The term Father is not to be confused with God the Father necessarily, but in this context instead refers to the enduring, compassionate, fatherly care of the Messiah to His people. A good father is a good provider. One of the names for God is Jehovah Jireh. This name means the Lord will provide. The name Jehovah Jireh is first seen in Genesis 22:14 when God provides a ram in the thicket in place of the sacrifice of Abraham's son. We see these words in Genesis, "Then Abraham lifted his eyes and looked, and there behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by its horns. So Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up for a burnt offering instead of his son. And Abraham called the name of that place, 'The Lord will provide,' as it is said to this day, 'In the mount of the Lord it shall be provided.'" Recently, I wasn't feeling real well, and so Karen took me to the doctor. And after the examination, the doctor pulled Karen off to the side and whispered to her, "I don't like the way your husband looks." And she said, "Neither do I, but he's a good provider." That wasn't a true story. She doesn't think I provide. That wasn't a true story either. Jesus said, "Which of you, if your son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a snake? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask Him?" So again this morning, we're thinking about the Messiah who would become the Everlasting Father. Christ is eternal and everlasting, without beginning or end of days. Remember what John wrote, speaking of the eternal existence of Christ. He wrote in John chapter 1, "In the beginning was the Word." Verse 14 defines the Word. It refers to Jesus. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God." Hebrews 1:8 says, "But to the Son, He says, 'Your throne, O God, is forever and ever.'" And I think we've been reminded in the last couple of decades that nothing in this world lasts forever. Men can make His monuments of concrete and steel, but they can fall into a pile of rubble in a few hours, as the World Trade Center buildings did 22 years ago. Businesses do not last forever. Remember any of these? You remember Blockbuster? Or Kodak? Polaroid? How about this one? JCPenney Auto Center. Does anybody remember JCPenney Auto Center? Not JCPenney Clothing. JCPenney Auto Center. Brad, you must have been a young man then. Still am. So I just wondering how you knew that. Karen picked that picture on purpose for her dad, who was an employee at the J.C. Penney Auto Center in Pekin, Illinois. And then there was Sears, and there was Radio Shack, and the list probably goes on and on. Huh? Montgomery Ward. There you go. The list goes on and on. But Rush Construction stays the course. By the way, did you know that birthdays are good for your health? That's right. Studies have shown that people who have more birthdays live longer. Thank you very much. I'll be here all night. Ted, you thought things had changed around here, and when you come back, it was going to be different, but it's not. That little pun had a point. Because even people don't last forever. No matter how much your parents love you or how much your husband or wife cares for you, if you live long enough, someday their lives will come to an end, and there's nothing you or they can do about it. But Jesus is different. As God promises, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And that's why the fact that He is eternal matters. That's why we care that Jesus will never change and never cease to exist. It means that all the good things He is to us now, He will always be to us. He will always be our provider. He will always be our protector. He will always be our Savior. He will always be our refuge. He will always be our strength. His love for us will never cease, either in this world or the next. In Christ, we have eternal joy. In Christ, we have eternal hope and glory and pleasure. In Christ, we will be eternally blessed and secure. Jesus will always keep His promises to us, even if other people don't. He'll always be our God, and we'll always be His people. So what does the fact that our relationship with Christ is eternal mean to us practically? Well, first, it means our joy in Him will be eternal. Isaiah 51:11 says, "Therefore the redeemed of the Lord shall return and come with singing unto Zion, and everlasting joy shall be upon their head, and they shall obtain gladness and joy, and sorrow and mourning shall flee away." Our joy can be lost in this life because stuff happens. People can try to steal our joy. Our joy can be lost because of circumstances. But in eternity, God guarantees that the saved will have everlasting joy. Joy that will never go away. And secondly, God's love and goodness toward us are eternal. They will never fail. Jeremiah 31:3 says, "The Lord has appeared of old to me, saying, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn you." And Paul says in Romans 8, those remarkable words, "For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." And finally, our salvation will be eternal. God's punishment and wrath against sin were completely executed in the death and suffering of Christ on the cross. So that those who are in Christ, there will never be any judgment or condemnation. God's attitude toward us will never be anything but total love and goodness. Again, I've shared this promise in God's Word, John 5:24. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he who hears my word and believes on him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. And the writer of Hebrews says this, therefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost who come unto God by him, seeing he lives forever to make intercession for them. So Jesus Christ is the everlasting Father. How should this fact affect our lives? Well, I think more than anything else, the eternal nature of Christ should help us get a proper perspective on this temporal life that we exist in now. 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 1, Paul says, while we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. So again, I don't know where you're at today, but it doesn't matter. Because no matter what you're going through, whether that's suffering or disappointment or pain or sorrow or confusion, no matter how other people may treat you, whether you've seen your highest dream realized or your greatest hopes dashed into 1,000 pieces, no matter what this life brings you, you can have peace, you can have contentment, because you can know that everything in this world is temporary, that it will soon pass away. But everything about Jesus is eternal. Our life in Christ is forever, provided that we continue to live for Christ all our days on earth after we become a Christian. Or as Jesus said, recorded in John 15, where he said, I am the true vine, my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it so that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine and you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit, for apart from me, you can do nothing. December 7th, 1941 was declared to be the day which will live in infamy. Franklin Roosevelt wrote that. It was the day the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor and drew the United States into World War II. That Sunday morning, two waves of planes descended on Pearl Harbor and destroyed 8 ships, 200-plus planes, and took 2,403 lives. Numerous sailors were trapped in their ships at Pearl Harbor. There was no way to rescue most of them. Rescuers were able to save 32 of the men from the capsized battleship Oklahoma, but the others were not reachable. On the night after the attack, a sailor by the name of Louis Grabinski from Erie, Pennsylvania, was sent to the battleship West Virginia as a sentry. He heard the sound of men beating on the hull from below and reported it to his supervisors. The trapped men were abandoned because of the overwhelming difficulties in trying to rescue them. These men were not the only ones trapped alive in the hulls of the severely damaged ships. Many of these men lived for 2 weeks or longer. Some even survived until Christmas. But eventually they suffocated, they died of thirst, or they starved to death. And isn't it horrible to know that someone needs to be saved, but you know there isn't a thing that you can do to help? You just have to stand by helplessly and take in their helpless situation. God knew our need for salvation, but He certainly was not helpless or hopeless. He sent part of Himself to a young virgin woman from Nazareth who conceived through the Holy Spirit and gave birth to the only begotten Son of God. Her betrothed husband, Joseph, was informed by God of what was happening and was obedient to God's call on his own life. And he called the Son of God by the name of Jesus. God saves. You've probably heard about Abraham. Abraham was a man of faith. God had promised him that he'd be the father to many. Yet Abraham had to wait until he was 100 years old before he became a father to one boy. Let's go back to the 22nd chapter of Genesis to see an odd event. It was the testing of Abraham's faith. It was one he would never forget. Scripture says, sometimes later, God tested Abraham, and he said to him, Abraham, here I am, he replied. Then God said, take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on a mountain I will show you. Early the next morning, Abraham got up and loaded his donkey. He took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. When he had cut enough wood for the burnt offering, he set out for the place God had told him about. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. He said to his servants, stay here with the donkey while I and the boy go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to you. Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and placed it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. As the two of them went on together, Isaac spoke up and said to his father, Abraham, Father? Yes, my son. Abraham replied, the fire and the wood are here, Isaac said, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? Abraham answered, God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son. And the two of them went on together. And when they reached the place God had told him about, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then he reached out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called out to him from heaven, Abraham, Abraham! Here I am, he replied. Do not lay a hand on the boy, he said. Do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son. Abraham looked up, and there in the thicket he saw a ram caught by its horns. He went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, the Lord will provide. And to this day it is said, on the mountain of the Lord it will be provided. Abraham was ready to sacrifice his one and only son to be obedient to God. He knew that God would provide what was needed, be it a substitutionary sacrifice or another son. Yet God spared Abraham's son and provided the substitute. And several thousand years later, God provides a substitutionary sacrifice for us. We were sinners. We were condemned to die. But God sent His own Son in our place and provided all that we needed through Him. For God so loved the world that He gave, provided His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And so during this Christmas season, we tend to focus on the miracle of Christ's birth, the shepherds, the angels, the wise men, the Virgin Mother, giving birth in what was perhaps a stable, the beauty and innocence of that babe in the manger. And it's entirely appropriate for us to do so. But we also need to remember why it was that Christ came, why he had to come. He came because we needed a Savior, because our sins had separated us from God, our Creator. And my question for you this morning is, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior? And what a better time than Christmas to meet the one whom the season is all about. Amen? Let's pray. Father God, thank you for this day. God, thank you for your incredible love for us in the sending of your own Son. Thank you that you are our Father. Thank you that Jesus was called our everlasting Father. Thank you for the promise that in Christ you'll never leave us nor forsake us. And so God, as we look at our own hearts and as you look into our heart, God, we're all making decisions. This is a decision time, whether we're in Christ or not. If we're outside of Christ, we decide to follow you for the first time. If we're in Christ already, we recommit ourselves to continue to follow you, to continue to pick up your cross and deny ourselves. And so, God, as you look into our hearts, I pray that you'd find us faithfully making the right decisions. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you be standing, please, as we sing our hymn of invitation? If you have a decision you need to make this morning, please come forward as we sing, "Oh Come All You Faithful."
One of the many lessons in the scripture teaches us that if we get our priorities right, that we can be generous on all occasions. That any time something comes up, we got our lives in order, and our bank accounts in order, we can be generous in all occasions. And if you would like to become generous on any occasion, I would highly recommend a financial peace class starting up January 10th. And they'll be on Wednesday nights here at Central, taught by Mike Whaley. If you have any questions, you can talk to Mike, but starting January 10th, 6:30 to 8:30 each Wednesday evening for 10 weeks. I think 10 weeks? 9 weeks. 9 weeks. I can't ever remember the amount. 9 weeks. This will get you started, get the ball rolling for you to get out of debt and start to plan for the future. So stop stressing and start winning with money. That's coming. And if you have any questions, see Mike. I invite you back tonight at 6 o'clock for our candlelight service. Also, if you haven't checked the tables in the back, in the foyer, there's a horseshoe of tables, and there's stacks of Christmas cards. And if you haven't checked that in a while, or even if you have checked that recently, there's probably more now. So check the tables. There's probably Christmas cards for you. Hope to see you tonight at 6 for our candlelight service. God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good. Let's close with Go Tell It on the Mountain. That's our job as Christians, isn't it? Not this season, but all seasons. Great week, great holiday, and hope to see you tonight.